Well, joining me now from Yerevan is Richard Giragosian. He is the director of the Regional Studies Center in Armenia. Also in Yerevan, we have Maria Karapetyan. She is the leader of the Reject Serzh movement. And completing our panel is Lilit Gevorgyan. She is a Russia analyst and joins us live from London. Thanks all so much for speaking to us. Let me begin with Richard. What is going on here? I mean, from the outside, it just looks like yet another ploy for a leader to circumvent the Constitution and hold on to power. Is it that simple?
In many ways, unfortunately, yes, it is that simple. This is more of a continuation of power by a ruling elite. But what's most interesting is the broader context. The government's plan for this parliamentary transformation is clearly not going according to the original plan. What we see is a rather unexpected determination by thousands of demonstrators, clearly anxious to register their opposition to this rather arrogance of power. What this also means, however, is not yet a revolutionary moment, but clearly well short of any resolution. Therefore, what we can expect reasonably is a deepening of simmering discontent and popular dissent, meaning that for both the opposition and the government, it will be very difficult, if not challenging, to return to a degree of normalcy.
Okay, Lilit, I mean, Sargsyan said he didn't believe anyone should serve more than two terms as a leader. And it's led some people to call him actually Armenia's Putin. Why is he doing this?
Well, I think I agree with the previous speaker that the transition to parliamentary democracy was our parliamentary system of government was a very convenient way of getting rid of those constraints on presidential terms. He is not an inventor of this sort of a method of staying in power. I'd like to remind you that this was done also in Georgia, where the previous president Saakashvili was also trying to sort of stay in power in a similar fashion, which didn't work. Now, another example, Kyrgyzstan, where they also transitioned from presidential to parliamentary system. However, there was a condition, and the condition was that whoever was standing as a president wouldn't run for prime minister's position, and that worked. So what Sargsyan did effectively said at a time, also to a degree to appease to the European Union, and especially Venice Commission, to say that, well, look, this is a genuine effort to bring more democracy to Armenia.
Okay.
And he backtracked.
Okay. Maria, let me ask you. I mean, we know where you stand. You head up the Reject Serzh movement itself. So tell us, what are the alternatives? If it's not Serzh Sargsyan, and we have to remind our viewers as well that the parliament voted overwhelmingly in favor of keeping him in power, but as prime minister, what would be better for Armenia? Is there an alternative that the opposition can actually present?
Right. Let me start with challenging that last point about the parliament voting overwhelmingly in favor. The group of people that has gathered in the National Assembly of Armenia has as little representational authority, or it actually has less representational authority than any 100 people that have gathered in any square of the cities of Yerevan today. Those people represent the society of Armenia much better than those that stand in the National Assembly. So right now we are in Armenia in a situation of a de facto constitution, in a de facto people who are in power, whereas the reality is quickly changing in the streets. Yeah, people are in the streets voting. The alternatives, I think that there are very many different political powers in Armenia that have various visions about what are the alternatives. And right now I do not believe that there should be one concrete specific, very detailed, structured vision. Of course, there needs to be an open debate. First, we need to remove this, this structure that has been keeping everyone blocked. And then there could be an open debate about the possibilities of how we want to move forward, because there is a lot of conversation about whether this transition to a parliamentary system was entirely staged to consolidate the power in Serzh Sargsyan's hands, or was it something that really was a necessary transition to democracy? So all of the processes that Armenia has gone through the last few years are challenged.
Okay.
Did we really need those things, or we need to actually unroll them?
Okay. Richard, I seemed you had something to say, but if not, I'd like to switch gears slightly in a question with you, but go ahead.
Well, I wanted to add, in terms of being fairly a little more objective, my criticism is equally shared by the opposition. And at this point, despite the intensity, the emotion, and the understandable frustration, I'm not sure that there is necessarily a viable alternative yet. But as indicated, the problem itself is now systemic, whether it's endemic corruption or systemic in terms of a closed political system. But I don't think any individual political party or politician will necessarily be the one answer for Armenia. What we need is to change political culture. And in effect, the lack of a free and fair election for so many years in Armenia is really the fundamental obstacle.
Okay. It's actually making democracy seem almost like a foreign institution more and more. But let me ask you this, Richard. I mean, part of what we saw in Georgia as well, Lilit had referred to Zakashvili. You know, the West was very pro-Georgia because Zakashvili himself was a Western-leaning leader. In the end, it didn't seem that that was actually what the Georgian people wanted, no matter how it was portrayed outside the country. Some say that's a bit of what we're seeing now in Armenia, that Serzh Sargsyan leaned toward Russia. Now, that's not very popular in the West, but within Armenia, it is playing out relatively well. Is that the case?
I would actually argue no. Ironically, just the opposite. Ironically, what we see under Sargsyan is a rare, belated recognition of the limits of the dangerous over-reliance on Russia. We see Armenia at the end of last year formally accepting and fully negotiating a new comprehensive agreement with the European Union. We see a new challenge to the relationship with Russia. We see the Armenian government still committed to normalization with Turkey, for example. Ironically, in foreign policy, Sargsyan and his government remains fairly credible and fairly competent. It's the domestic situation, however, that presents the bigger problems. But I would say the real obstacle here is much less Russia and much more the internal situation.
Okay.
Ironically, however, there will come a point where perhaps Moscow begins to express concern over their reliance on the current Armenian government. Because after all, the former prime minister of Armenia is a Gazprom executive who was sent to Armenia from Moscow.
Richard alludes to something important there, that many say Sargsyan's leadership is very closely tied with Armenia's oligarchs. The accusation that Sargsyan and his cohorts are very closely tied and entrenching the power, essentially, of Armenia's oligarchs.
Yeah, I would rather say it's a description rather than an accusation, because truly Serzh Sargsyan is the head of that pyramid where different interest groups have been put into place to support each other, yeah? And that's why the smallest common denominator for all of the civic movements and the political parties right now in this strife are targeting him personally. And the initiative that I'm part of, Reject Serzh, also targets him. But this doesn't mean that the only change that we want to see is his non-return to power or removal from power. There is much more that goes beyond it. But since this person is the one that keeps this system into a state of homeostasis, if we change him, then everything will start collapsing in that system of oligarchic power in the politics.
What does it mean to have, if it is, as Maria was describing, a leader in Armenia that is so closely tied to the oligarchs of the country?
Well, I mean, the fact that our Armenian economy is suffering because of the high concentration of economic power in hands of few has been recognized by international organizations and lenders, including IMF. So it's not an allegation, rather than a fact and a serious problem for Armenia's economic development. So in this sense, one of the reasons why there is so much discontent is precisely because of this economic system not working for ordinary Armenians. And I'll bring you one example why it's not working. Armenia posted 7.5% annual growth in 2017. It's a remarkable number that many countries in the world will be very much envious of. But at the same time, the poverty levels in the country are rising, which suggests that there is an extreme polarization of wealth in the country. And this is happening because of the oligarchic system. An oligarchy strives and thrives in Armenia simply because it has also the political power. So what, in a nutshell, we're seeing on the streets of Armenia is a message that we don't know how we're going to change the system, but it's a message that it's not working. And it's not really about the leaders on the street, who is leading them, or what agenda they have. It is simply expression of a desperation, saying that the economy is not working and your foreign policy is not working either. Because when Armenia was joining Eurasia Union, led by Russia, and leaving the association agreement with European Union behind, the promise from Sarkisian's government was that Armenia would benefit from Russian investment, from cheap gas, and there will be solid security guarantees for Armenian Nagorno-Karabakh.
Okay.
And none of this has worked.
Right. I mean, Richard, you're connection has been established again. That kind of brings us back to the initial point that you were talking about when you disagreed with Maria. This is not, according to all of you, the ideal leadership for Armenia, but is it the best of poor alternatives?
I would argue yes, but for a slightly different reason. The reason I'm optimistic clearly is because Sargsyan, as former president, now as prime minister, is very much the last of the Mohicans, the last of this oligarchic elite. The new transformation has also been matched by a political transition to much younger faces, even within the ruling Republican Party. And this demographic change is largely inspiring change, because they realize there is no alternative but reform. And it's not only political weakness or lack of legitimacy, it's economic vulnerability that will force open the closed economic system. But in many ways, it's too premature to predict where this is going, but it's inevitable that change is now much past due.
Okay. Lilit, if you had a comment, I could see you disagreed. Go ahead. If not, I'd like to move on to Maria. Go ahead.
I disagree on one point, that I see a transition to younger politicians from the same party, from the same ruling oligarchic elite, is a simple cosmetic move. In fact, I would argue that it's even dangerous, because the only advantage that this supposed progressive leaders, young leaders, have is just their age gap with the current leaders. And they have formed their vision, their skills that they've acquired in a oligarchic, in a corrupt system. I do not think that they have vision. They have progressed their career in a system which is not based on meritocracy. So I do not think that they have the skills and qualities to lead to change.
Okay. That's definitely a less optimistic outlook. And I want to get final words from Maria, not just on that, the fact that the only difference between the youth, the old guard and the new guard possibly in Armenia is the age gap, but also the fact that, you know, somewhere between 270 and 370,000 people have emigrated from Armenia. You can call it even a brain drain if you want. That is never healthy for a country. What could bring them back, or do you fear that actually that brain drain might increase now that this government has headed on the path it's headed on?
Well, first of all, I think we're in a process that is actually on its way to its culmination. So I'm very hopeful that this is going to be the beginning of changes in Armenia. And I do not want to consider the scenario of further stagnation and more emigration out of the country. But truly, the people that have emigrated are partially the let's say, the young minds that have not seen the realization of their dreams in this country, and also people that have not seen that have not found jobs to stay in this country. And also adding to that emigration is the growing poverty rate, which has grown by some few percent, which might seem small, but if you take into consideration that part of the people that have emigrated are already from the poorest layers of the society, then this growth, or the remaining like 30% of poor poverty in Armenia, shows that more and more layers of the society are getting poorer and poorer. But coming back to your point about bright minds and their possible return, I do believe that people that leave Armenia still maintain some ties with the society, with the country. They join the diaspora communities and stay in touch. So there is the possibility that if they see a vision, if they see the way towards changes, some people might come back. And right now, even, we are hearing a lot of the voices from the communities that have gone out of the country in support of these changes. And we do hope that there will be more voices joining.
Okay, Maria, I will have to give you the last word. Unfortunately, we're out of time for this segment of the Newsmakers. I'd like to thank all three of our panelists so much for joining us.
Thank you.